From Music City, USA, it's David Hooper and Music Business Radio.
From the TuneIn Broadcasting Studios in Nashville, Tennessee, this is Music Business Radio. I'm your host, David Hooper, and with me today, he's the producer of the best-selling all-genre artist of 2008, the best-selling country album of 2008, and the best-selling album of 2009 so far. Triple platinum in just 13 weeks. The artist, Taylor Swift, and her producer, Nathan Chapman, is here today. Nathan, welcome to Music Business Radio.
How you doing?
Not only are you a producer, you're like the triple threat. Guitar player and a writer.
Yeah, well, nowadays it helps to be able to do a lot of things, you know. the jack of all trades thing definitely applies.
Diversify, you got those multiple streams. I think it's pretty cool, too, when they need a guitar track. Hey, Nathan, come on in here, step on the other side of the glass, and let's do this thing. Or they need a song, you know, you're there, so...
I love being on the other side of the glass. Sometimes songwriter friends of mine will have me be a guitar player on their demo session or something, and I just come hang and make music with people. That's what it's all about.
Well, I imagine it helps you be a better producer when you can talk to musicians like you would want to be talked to.
Right, yeah.
So let's talk about how you got started. I mentioned you've had a lot of success with Taylor Swift. Weren't always that successful. Talk about how you started.
Well, I got started, my wife's a great singer-songwriter, Stephanie Chapman, and she and I just set off in life to make music. Out of kind of necessity, I started learning how to produce a song because she would write a song and we'd want to record it and we'd want to have more than just guitar and vocal. So I started playing all the instruments and programming drums and programming bass and all that kind of stuff. And that's where it all started.
And are you originally from Nashville or did you move here for country music or another reason?
I grew up here. My mom and dad actually moved here to do Christian music in the 70s.
Okay.
Before there was contemporary Christian music, this wave of Christian rock happened in the late 70s, and they were part of that.
You grew up around this. I mean, it was kind of like...
Yeah. I grew up in studios and playing concerts and living that life.
Well, did that make it easier for you to break in? Did you have, like, friends in the business or relatives, friends, and, you know, people that you were associated with, or did you still have to kind of pay your dues like everybody else?
Philosophically and mentally and musically, yes, it helped, but Christian music and country music are pretty different worlds as far as, like, who you know. And my mom and dad are well-connected in the Christian industry, but I wanted to do country music and pop music, and that didn't help me at all. But knowing what I knew and having the background and having spent a lot of time in studios and stuff with engineers and guitar players, it helped out.
Well, you know, just another indication that the music industry is such a small world. When we were walking in the Music Business Radio studios today, you said, oh, yeah, hey, I was going to rent this place.
Yeah. I rented a place here in this building for about a month. It all went wrong. So I left.
Well, you know, this actually is supposed to be our temporary studios. We've been here about 3 years, though. So
as soon as you leave, you can say it was temporary.
It's one of those things. Probably not really set up to be a studio, but it's a cool building. It used to be an old automotive factory. A lot of space.
Yep.
Hardwood, a lot of light.
Yep.
So I imagine it'd be pretty cool if you could throw up a studio in here or something.
It had its thing.
How did you get connected with Taylor Swift? What's the story behind that?
Well, like I said, my wife and I were making her songs, and she got a writing deal at Jody Williams Music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've had Jody on the show before.
Yep, and she wrote for him, and that was a co-venture with Sony, and she still writes now for Sony. But she and Liz Rose started writing a lot, and the two of them had a cut together on a Trisha Yearwood album, and also Bonnie Raitt's album, Souls Alike. They had a cut on there together. And so me and Stephanie and Liz kind of started doing this thing, and then Liz Rose and Taylor started writing together. I had started doing not only Stephanie's demos, but I was doing all of Liz's demos, even for writers outside of Stephanie. And then when Taylor and Liz started writing together, it was just kind of a natural thing to say, Liz told Taylor, hey, I want my guy that plays all the instruments to produce the demos of these songs that we're working on. And so that's how Taylor and I got in the room together making music.
So you're doing demos at first, and then she liked what you were doing there. And
the demos that I did with Taylor, we just had a great connection right off the bat. We didn't have to sit around and discuss the production ideas together. It's just her songwriting and my kind of default buttons worked really well together. And in my head, I was trying to impress the guys that she was working with at the time, trying to get in with them, and ended up at a certain point in the process of making her album, she asked her label if they would give me a shot on three songs to produce. And that's where we got in the studio together for the first time, like legitimate producer and artist kind of thing, as opposed to this guy making her demos. So it was all her idea, and I was really grateful.
Well, that sounds like pretty good advice for upcoming producers, like get aligned with an artist that goes somewhere and they can bring you in with them.
Yeah, and it wasn't intentional at all. It was just that I just loved making music with her and never dreamed that I could be her producer and that we would sell so many records like that. You know, when you're making demos,
I was going to ask you that. You just never dream
about it. You just do your best. And she and I, neither one of us had ever been in the marketplace. We were both brand new, and so there wasn't any pressure on us, and we just made the best music we could together.
That's exactly what I was going to ask you. So you just concentrated on the music, and the rest of it kind of worked itself out.
I knew that she was going to be successful, but even when she gave me the first three songs to do, how can you dream it would all go that right?
You've got a song here, well, three versions of a song called Teardrops. Kind of give me the story behind this, because I think this is interesting how you guys are remixing this.
Yeah, it's a big thing to do in the industry. I think it's probably been for a long time, but doing different mixes for different genres and different radio formats is something that's worked really well for Taylor. She's got a core audience base in country music, and those fans are diehard, and she loves those fans. And then just kind of the way her artistry has gone, she's been able to reach out and bring people from pop into country music, and one way that she's done that is with these remixes. And there's actually four versions. This is only three versions of the song. The fourth version that I didn't bring in is just the original demo that we made. But I brought in, just for fun, you know, I brought in the album cut of Teardrops on My Guitar, the country radio single of Teardrops on My Guitar, the pop top 40 version. And so, you know, the album version was something that I wasn't thinking that it would be a single. I just did the artsiest thing I could do. I wanted there to be a real artsy track on the record. Mm-hmm. And then when they picked it for a single, the label said, hello, you know, we need something that sounds good on the radio. And I was like, oh, yeah. So I went in and kept the same lead vocal.
Yeah.
Re-recorded the track with a click and her vocal and redid everything. And then the top 40 version, we stripped it all down again, built it up from nothing.
Well, this is something that I think a lot of our listeners are going to find familiar, because after all, she was the best-selling artist of 2008. So congratulations for that.
Thank you.
Taylor Swift, this is the album version of Teardrops on Music Business Radio.
So he won't see.
Teardrops by Taylor Swift here on Music Business Radio. Producer Nathan Chapman here in the studio with me. And that was the album version.
That's the album. That's like a verse and chorus of the album version.
That's the one that everybody's heard because everybody and their brothers bought this album.
And that's me singing harmony on there too. So,
man, that's got to be kind of cool.
I love singing harmony. I just love all of it.
Well, yeah, I looked at your discography. You actually sing a lot of harmony.
Yeah, I do. I sing probably on almost everything I do. I end up singing harmony on it somewhere. So that would be the album cut. I don't know if we have time, if we want to play the country radio version.
Absolutely. I'd like to know, give us an intro on this. Like, what was it that you needed to change? Maybe put in more, like, lap steel or pedal steel or country type? I mean, was there, like, a formula that you tried to go for with this?
It's the same lead vocal in all three versions. Basically, the difference in these two versions, it would be big pop ballad drums and some sweeping electric guitars would probably be the biggest obvious differences.
For the country version?
Yeah, for the country radio version.
Okay, so let's check it out. This is the country radio version of Teardrops, Taylor Swift. Nathan Chapman, the producer, is my guest today on Music Business Radio, Teardrops by Taylor Swift, country version.
Looks at me. I fake a smile so he won't see. That girl he talks about, and she's got everything that I have to live without. Drew talks to me. I play
finally got it right. I wonder if he knows he's all I think about at night. He's the reason for the teardrops on my guitar. The only thing that keeps me wishing on a wishing star. He's the song in the car I keep singing, don't know why I do.
Taylor Swift does the country version of Teardrops. Nathan Chapman, the producer, is my guest today here on Music Business Radio. And so you wanted, I guess, that chorus to really pop, kind of some sounds that maybe country listeners were more familiar with.
Yeah, and the drummer on that track is a guy named Dave Harrison. He played on all the big Edwin McCain hits.
Oh, okay.
And so it got a little bit of that street cred on this track, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And he's a great guy, great drummer.
And the other one's the rock version, I guess, pop.
The third version is the most different, and that one is something that I've kept the fiddle. Because it kind of played it like a violin. Rob Hajek is a great fiddle player. But everything else is completely just programmed. And this was the most different version. And this one I played everything except for those fiddle tracks in the background. So this is back in the old days of playing everything.
So here it is, Taylor Swift, the pop top 40 version of Teardrops.
Drew looks at me. I fake a smile so he won't see.
Yeah, that's the top 40. And actually cut that and mixed it and everything right down the hall in your building here. So there you go.
So the magic not only happens here in the Music Business Radio studios, but just this whole building is
absolutely
great.
Magic.
Check us out online at musicbusinessradio.com if you want to know where we are and how you can rent some space here.
Yeah.
So Nathan, I got a lot more questions about how this all happened. More from Nathan Chapman when Music Business Radio returns right after this.
Just never grow old, like the timeless music at Music City Roots and a warm bowl of all-natural Vietti chili. For over 100 years in Nashville, Vietti has been a hometown brand, and you can find your own true taste, whether it's chili with beans or without beans, chili mac, or even spicy Louisiana hot sauce chili. You'll experience the taste that has been uniquely Nashville since 1898. I'm Allie Sutton, reminding you to pull the tab and feel the love. Check us out at VietiChili.com.
Miko, an artist on MySpace Records /DGC. You can visit me at MikoMusic.com, and you're listening to Music Business Radio.
It is Music Business Radio from the TuneIn Broadcasting Studios in Nashville, Tennessee. I'm David Hoop, your host, and with me, he is the producer for the best-selling all-genre artist of 2008, Nathan Chapman, the artist, of course, Taylor Swift. And before the break, we are listening to the three different versions, the album version, the country version, and the top 40 pop version of Teardrops on My Guitar. And here's my question for you, Nathan. Was that part of the big plan? Did you guys know that this thing was just going to be a monster radio hit and a monster album? So, hey, let's do three mixes. That makes sense. I mean, when does that come into the plan? Because that seems like a great idea. It's like really drilling down into that niche and giving the people exactly what they want that are listening to that station.
You know, when they need it, we'll deal with it when we get there. Oh, and a couple of the tracks on Fearless, we kind of anticipated that need would happen. And so, like, the song Love Story, that was the first single off of Fearless, we had a pop version ready as soon as the country single dropped. But how big everything got was the vision of Taylor and Scott Borchetta, the president of Big Machine Records. They had this vision that it could be this big, And they've worked really hard to make that happen. But I think the needs of the productions and the songs and the musical side of things has just kind of, a need pops up. And if Taylor needs to write it, she writes it. If we need to produce it, we produce it. It just kind of happens on the fly, like the good old days.
Now, not to take away from your talent as a producer, but you've worked with a lot of artists. And one of the things that I keep hearing over and over again about Taylor Swift is that how great she is with the fans and what a hard worker she is.
Absolutely.
Talk about that. Talk about what she's done to make this album as big as it is.
Yeah, I think that, you know, Taylor is an unbelievable songwriter, and she's amazing live performer, amazing with the fans, amazing when she's talking to the press. You can't have success without that. But she also, you know, she needs the production to be right, and she needs the radio promoters to do their jobs, and everybody contributes. But without that artist in the middle of the craziness being amazing, then, you know, it's just, it's not going to happen. And I can do the best job I've ever done for a lot of people, and I'm sure sometimes it'll work and sometimes it won't. And sometimes you can point the finger at other members of the team. People will drop the ball. I think a lot of times when something's this successful, you just have to hand the credit to the artist.
And I know when something gets this successful, there's probably a lot of pressure on both of you guys to do it again and continue the process. Can you talk about the pressure that you've had to deal with since you have an artist so big on your production roster now?
Yeah, I think the Fearless album that's done really well was a lot of sleepless nights and a lot of wondering how it would be received. Taylor has continued to grow as a songwriter, as a vocalist. And for me, it was the first time I'd ever worked on anything that I knew was going to be on the radio. And that really changed it for me, because up to that point, you know, doing songwriter demos and the first album with Taylor, you don't have that feeling that what I'm doing right now, I better make the right decision right now, because this is going to be in the marketplace. Mm-hmm. And when you have that in your brain, that affects the way you work. It actually made me work better, which I was grateful for. It didn't shut me down creatively. It kind of added to the energy of the project. And one thing that I kind of felt like that, I felt like that on the album, there had to be moments where the production was really stripped down to let people feel like that they could get to know Taylor, because there's just so much press and publicity and video clips and this and that. And it's like, I wanted the album to be a place where they feel like that they could come and hang out with Taylor. There's a few of the tracks on there that are the big, large radio things. But, and this was something that Taylor also believed, you know, and there's a track on the album called The Best Day, which is just a couple of acoustics, brush drums and bass and her vocal. She wanted to have some tracks on there like that. I did too. And it was just kind of like, let's let people in instead of shutting them out with trying to overproduce everything.
I certainly get that from her. I mean, you're talking about a huge, huge country artist here. But when you listen to it, just like we just did, I mean, there's like a sense of vulnerability there, which really comes through. And I think it does help people to feel like they know her.
That's what an artist like Taylor and, you know, there's some of our greatest artists in country music, I would say, like Garth Brooks and the iconic artists, they have a way of kind of reaching through the glass on the TV, reaching through the car stereo, and you feel like you're in the room with them. And I think that that's just a gift that some of these artists have, and that's all I know about that, is that she does that.
You're listening to Music Business Radio. I'm your host, David Hooper, and with me today, Nathan Chapman. He's a guitarist, songwriter, and producer. Latest thing he's done, Taylor Swift Fearless, which is just a phenomenal album. Nathan, what gets your attention when an artist is approaching you? Because I'm sure after the success of an album like this, that there are tons of artists approaching you, tons of labels, tons of managers. A lot of people want to work with you right now. So what is it that gets your attention?
I like artists that write songs. They don't have to write every song on the album, but I like to work with artists that write songs. And I think that I like to work with artists that sound different than everybody else. I like the idea of a singer that you can pick out in a lineup.
Mm-hmm. Just something distinct.
Something distinct and somebody with something to say.
Well, is that why you like them to write their own songs? It's like they have some kind of feel for who they are as a person rather than just maybe like a puppet?
Yeah, and part of it's just as a creative person, because sometimes you can be a producer and you're managing a project and you're getting songs and you're not the guy playing the guitar. Some of my heroes don't play or sing a note. They don't mix. They don't engineer. They just produce the album. And like one of my heroes is Mark Wright, and he's not the guy in there playing and singing like I am.
Yeah, but Rick Rubin's that way, one of the most successful producers.
Absolutely,
ever.
Absolutely. And then there's the guys like Danny Lanois and John Shanks, who are also heroes of mine, who play and write and can sing. And like Danny Lanois makes his own albums, which are amazing. And Buddy Miller is another guy in that category for me. And I'm would like to call myself more in that style of production. So part of the reason I like for artists to be writers is because you get bogged down looking for songs. Like that whole A&R song search, publishing companies pitching songs to you, and writer, it's just, for me as a creative person, I can get bogged down fast.
Give me some stories about how Taylor got her songs.
Well, Taylor's just, I mean, she co-writes sometimes, and on this Fearless album, I think 9 of the tracks she wrote by herself. She just shows up with unbelievable songs that she wrote, and then we just produce the songs. As a producer, I'm not having to go out and look all over Music Row looking for a hit. You know, she's bringing them in. It frees up so much of your brain to just get to be creative on the tracks.
How does it normally work with somebody who isn't as prolific a writer as Taylor is?
Yeah, and a lot of times it's kind of a hybrid. You know, you find a song that's a big hit, and you get it on hold, and you cut that with the artist because they believe in the song. But sometimes you can get bogged down with, like, I probably get 30 to 40 songs pitched to me a day via email, and it's just hard to keep up. And it's a part of my brain that is hard to turn on and turn off. It'd be dreamy if they all wrote them all, but they don't.
Well, are those guys pitching you? Are they just your average country music fan who has a song in their heart that's hunting you down, or are they actually
publishers? No, these are all legitimate, and they're great songs. That's the thing. It's not that I get pitched bad songs and that I don't like hearing them. It's just not the creative thing. And I think, like I was saying, a guy like Mark Wright or Rick Rubin or these guys, their creative expression is finding the right song and placing that with the artist.
Well, you know, speaking of the right song, we have a section of this show. We call it Dave's Demo Derby.
Okay.
And bands, musicians from around the world have sent in demos, sometimes songs, people looking to get the songs cut. We're going to listen to those later on in the show.
Okay.
Right now, we've got a quick break. I've got some more questions for you when we come back. That's next on Music Business Radio.
Hi, this is Clay Myers with Stillwork in Music, and you're listening to Music Business Radio, the best show ever.
You're listening to Music Business Radio on the web at musicbusinessradio.com.
Lightning 100's One Night Stand live at Zany's is proud to present Comedians at Law. Bad at law, good at comedy.
My parents have been married for 55 years.
Whoa!
Yeah. My dad has become a narcoleptic.
Tickets available by calling the Zany's box office or online at zanys.com. Wednesday, live at Zany's, Comedians at Law.
He comes home from work, sits down in his chair, and it's... And he gets right up into his face and starts going... Sit,
Zany's
sit,
and Lightning 100 sit, presents sit, the funniest sit, one-night sit, stand sit, without sit, the walk of shame.
Now back to Music Business Radio on Lightning 100.
25, 06, 24. Oh, yeah. Hi, this is Lee Lockman from Chicago, and you're listening to Music Business Radio.
This is Music Business Radio from the TuneIn Broadcasting Studios in Nashville, Tennessee. I'm David Hoop, your host, and with me, producer, songwriter, guitar player, and harmony singer, Nathan Chapman. Nathan, did you ever imagine that you were going to be this big? When you set out to make music with your wife and become a producer, did you ever think, like, hey, man, I'm going to have people like Sara Evans calling me up to produce her?
I had absolutely no idea, and I still don't think any of it can sink in. And I don't really want it to. You know, I still have a lot to prove, and it makes me feel really weird for someone to say that I'm big or something. That's just...
I'm going to keep saying it because it makes me sound better. I think that's brilliant, though. So you're not going to stand still and just live off this one album. You're continuing to do this stuff and work as hard as you did before that.
I look at the careers of my heroes, and they had their first couple of big albums with artists that changed their life, and then they work hard to maintain that and to keep... trying to achieve more than they've ever achieved. And if we want to put things in perspective, there's this new guy on the scene, Mutt Lang, you know.
Right.
I think they credit 900 million records sold.
That's a lot.
I think someone guessed that he's made over $1 billion as a songwriter and producer. I think about that when I go to work, and he's forgotten more hits than I've ever had. And I think that Taylor, and I think that the other artists that I work with, they all think that way too. That's the drive that gets you here. And if this is as far as you want to get, your first couple of big albums, Taylor's first headlining tour, if that's all her goal was, and if this is all my goal was to get this far and then quit, I don't think we would have had what it takes to get this far.
Talk about your day-to-day. Is it, now that you've had all this success, is it actually more work than it was before you had this kind of success?
I'm kind of a workaholic. My wife keeps me healthy by making me stop sometimes and...
Got to have that balance.
Watch some TV or right. Eat food. And I'm not skinny. I don't know how that works. I wish I was like really skinny, like Bongo Java skinny.
Well, listen, you know, they tell you, they say never trust a skinny producer because that means he's not making money.
Well, no,
so I mean, that's a good thing.
The people that I know that have more money than me are all thinner than me. Here's a little backstory. This is probably everyone's going to turn the dial right now. But my mom's dad, my grandpa on my mom's side, was a dairy farmer. And he worked from sunup to beyond sundown every single day. The last words he said in his life were, "Take my boots off." He died working. And my mom has, like, instilled in me this work ethic that is so just overwhelming that if I'm not working, I feel weird.
Mm-hmm.
And so a typical day for me is I'm up by 8 and I'll do some Pro Tools editing at the house, and then I'm out the door. I try to write a song every day from 10 to 2, grab a bite to eat, go home or to a studio and do overdubs and editing, and I go to bed around 2 in the morning, and I just go. I try not to think about what I'm doing, and I just try to keep going. Some people would probably be less creative. When I take a few days off, I go nuts, and then when I try to get back into it, I'm not on my game.
So it's not like when I look at like Puff Daddy going to all these parties and these famous producers, you're actually having to stay in the studio and write songs and twiddle knobs and things.
Well, before I ever had anything on the radio when I was doing demos all the time, I would leave on a Friday night at like 1:30 in the morning, let's say. I would leave the studio to go home, and I would drive by on Demumbrian, and I would go by the Tin Roof and all those bars, and I would see all these people drinking and having fun, and I used to think to myself, but half the people there are trying to schmooze their way into a gig.
Yeah.
I'm going to work my way into a gig. Nothing against them and nothing against people taking that career path, but it always made sense to me to just work by myself and hope for the best.
Well, so. and it obviously paid off. Music Business Radio on the air, online at musicbusinessradio.com. I'm David Hooper, your host, and with me today, Nathan Chapman. He's a producer for Taylor Swift, and also you're working on the new Sara Evans as well.
Yes.
How did that come about?
She and her manager thought about me, so I went and met with her, and we got together to try and write a song. I like to write songs first with people just to see if there's a creative spark there, and we wrote 2 songs in 3 hours and hit it off.
Not bad.
Yeah, she's amazing. She's a great singer, great writer. She's everything you want an artist to be. I'm really excited to be on that project. I'm really pumped. Just real quick, now it's like I've got this band called The Invite that I am producing. They're on Atlantic out of New York, doing country music. They're label mates in the Atlantic New Country Division with Zach Brown Band and Jesse Lee.
Mm-hmm.
I did some tracks with Jesse Lee on her new project coming out. I did about 4 or 5 of those. Mark Bright did the rest of it. And then I'm starting the new Point of Grace country album. They want to do a positive country thing. Mm-hmm. So that's another project.
Well, that's where that Christian background helped out.
Warner Brothers Nashville is a sister label to Word Records, and they called me to cut a single on them. And when I kind of got in that world, I'd grown up knowing Point of Grace's manager. Point of Grace knew about my mom and dad and their music, and that does make the connection better.
Speaking of your mom and dad, we didn't really go into that. I was joking around with you off mic. Say, is it Stephen Curtis Chapman?
No, it's not Stephen Curtis.
And it's
Chapman.
Not. So let everybody know who your parents are.
My mom and dad are Steve and Annie Chapman, and they were a duo since 1980. Before that, my dad had a band called Dogwood, not the current heavy rock band called Dogwood that is a Christian band, the Dogwood of the 70s, and Pat Boone signed him to a record deal. And my dad, Amy Grant, used to open for him, and then he opened for Amy Grant 5 minutes later after she was
right,
huge.
Right, right.
And so I know Amy Grant. I know that crowd of people. A lot of has to do with the Belmont Church that's on Music Row.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Michael W. Smith came out of there, and Amy Grant and my mom and dad, and a lot of different people came out of that music scene that was in that church. And I grew up in the middle of all that. Don Potter was a mentor of mine. Associate produced all the Judds records.
Mm-hmm.
And then this mixing engineer named Gary Hedden was a mentor of mine, too. He's worked on a lot of recordings with Michael Jackson and Pink Floyd and Gloria Estefan. He's got a Grammy for the Dylan and the Dead live record. And he used to sit and let me watch him mix for hours because he just decided he liked me.
Do you think those early experiences had something to do with who you are now?
Absolutely. I mean, I'm only 31 years old, and, you know, in the marketplace, I'm hanging with guys that are at least 10 years older than me who are producers. So I definitely had a head start when I decided to do this, just based on my upbringing.
What is your advice for upcoming producers?
My first advice would be kind of that insane work ethic thing. If you can find it in yourself to outwork the next guy, you don't ever have to be dishonest. You don't ever have to undercut anybody or try and snag a gig. if you just outwork the next guy, then you legitimately can get work that he wouldn't get or she. Just work on your craft. For me, it's always been, I'll play songs that sound unbelievable. Like one of my favorite mixes ever is a Switchfoot song on the, I think it's the Nothing Is Sound album. It's the opening track. Chris Lordauge, Switchfoot, John Fields producing, guitars, drums, everything is just beautiful. I play that track all the time and put my mixes or my productions up against that. I haven't gotten there yet, but I will. But the toms and the snare and the kick on that song, it just, you know, it's insane. But I'm getting really close. You know, and it's different styles, but I feel like the way those drums make me feel when I hear them back, I've got goals with that kind of stuff, and I just keep, I keep holding Mutt Lang's career, certain productions that I like. If I can keep working toward that, that's, and I would suggest that to any young guy to, like, or girl, to put those productions and those careers right in front of your face and try to work toward that at all times.
We know your day starts at 8 a.m., ends about 1:30, 2 a.m., long day. I want to know real quick, what's the best part and what's the worst part of being in the music business?
Well, the best part about the creative side of it is all of it. And it's weird because I'll play a guitar overdub and then I'll sing a harmony and then I'll have to do a quick mix and then I'll edit a vocal. At every stage, I honestly, and I'm not trying to be cheesy, but at every stage, I'm like, if this was my only job, I would love my job.
Mm-hmm.
And if when I'm playing electric guitar, I want to be the greatest electric guitar player and I want to buy gear, and then I'll play acoustic for a couple days and be like, I never want to play electric again. I love acoustic. I want to go to Gruen's. And like, it's just, I'm obsessively in love with every part of it. Even editing vocals is fun, you know?
Yeah.
And like, it's just weird that I love all of it so much. My least favorite part of it is the political landmines that you can find without knowing it. You know, you can accidentally mess up politically. You can say the wrong thing to somebody or not return a phone call to the wrong person or just mess up.
It's a really tight business.
It is, and I really try to do my best. One of my least favorite parts is actually talking about what I do, so this would have to be in that category, and I apologize. But I'm here, and, you know, it's good. Well, I feel grateful that you guys want to hear what's going on in my head, even though I don't even want to hear that.
Well, you know, we were joking around about it, how quick it's going. And I said, you know, off mic, I said, well, it's not nearly as long as it takes for you to record a record.
Yeah.
Talk about that as a perfect segue. How long does it take to do a major label album?
I think probably a good number in your head is 6 months. But it's not like for 6 months, the only thing I work on is one project. It's just, it takes time to, I like to live with tracks. I would never want to block out a month and do an album from start to finish. I like to track, live with it, overdubs, live with it, vocals, live with it, mix, live with it. So hopefully if I can avoid a deadline that's too close to the start of a project, then you can drag it out as long as you can. And there shouldn't be any ideas that are sacred. So if you get down the road and this old guitar part that you spent 4 hours trying to get perfect, it's not working anymore, then you get rid of it and try something else.
Yeah, like don't be attached to them.
Yeah, there's probably more tracks, especially on Fearless, because I had to nail that album. If I've ever nailed an album, I had to nail that one. And so far, it's doing really well, and I'm grateful for that. But there's probably more tracks. This is for all you Pro Tools nerds out there. There's probably more inactive tracks than there are active tracks in the sessions. There's more ideas that got thrown away. I keep them just in case, but more things that I've recorded and then got rid of than are actually on the tracks.
Well, that is a sign of a smart producer. And coming up next, we've got something I've been teasing it the whole show. It's called Dave's Demo Derby. And sometimes there's stuff that probably should have been thrown away that ends up on the tape and we have to listen to it. So we're going to check that out. Dave's Demo Derby is next when we come back on Music Business Radio.
This is David Groh with HowlingMusic.com.
This is Holly Baranski from Four Corners Artist Management.
Hey, this is Pat Higdon from Universal Music Publishing.
Hi, I'm Dale Turner with Lyric Street Records, and you're listening to Music Business Radio.
On the web at MusicBusinessRadio.com.
Lightning 100. 100.1.
What's your social calendar looking like on Tuesday nights? Don't lie, you're free, but you're probably sick of the same old Two for Tuesday crowd or too many people cheating at trivia night. Yeah, we know. We got something for you. Beer, bands, and bingo. Starting at 7:30 every Tuesday night from Tin Roof, Nashville. My name, Wells Adams. Join me and grab a bingo card, a dollar, and a bucket of Henry Winehearts and enjoy the classic game with the new rock star twist. Every Tuesday, you can win CDs, T-shirts, drinks, concert tickets, and a killer grand prize. Bingo's free. The prizes you can win are awesome. So grab your friends, form a bingo team, win some stuff. Beer, bands, and bingo. Powered by Henry Wine Arts and Lightning 100. See you Tuesday at 7:30 in Tin Roof, Nashville.
But it's you I fell into. Hi, everybody. I'm Dave Grohl of the Foo Fighters. You're listening to Music Business Radio.
Yes, you are. And now it's time for that part of the show we call Dave's Demo Derby. Producer Nathan Chapman is my guest today. And in between us, we've got a big box of demos sent in from bands and musicians all around the world. Just a few seconds, we'll be reaching into that box, picking one out, playing it on the radio, and reviewing the music that it contains. Nathan, are you ready for this?
I think I am.
This is kind of like getting ready to produce a record, isn't it?
This is nothing like getting ready to produce a record. This is so hard for me.
So it's a lot more fun. Well, you hadn't heard them yet.
Okay.
It might get real painful here. Or we might find the next hit.
You never know.
First up, Adam Foster. The song is Old and Gray, and Adam is from Albany, New York. Music Business Radio. Old and Gray is the song, and if you like him, he's at adamfoster.com. And that is the big question, Nathan. Do you like him?
I do. I like it. It has like a the band, Neil Young.
I was thinking that, yep.
Kind of feel to it. On a production standpoint, I think it would have been cool if it was just one acoustic guitar. I think it was doubled, or it was a 12-string.
Mm-hmm.
The electric guitar tone, if it sounded older, it would have sold the track, and like there's no auto-tune on the vocal and everything. As far as the songwriting, it was really good, and I think his voice is cool. You know, this is my first time of critiquing someone on the radio.
It's not easy, is it?
It's not easy, but I would say that I like it a lot, and that it sounds like that if you put that guy and his songwriting in a situation where the sonics match the songwriting style,
mm-hmm,
it can sound really classic.
Talk more about that, because the recording has to match the songwriting style, has to match the artist.
Yeah, well, a really good example, like my wife and I, Stephanie Chapman, we still make music together, and we just got done with her album, and we co-produced it. We brought in a referee.
Mediation.
Yes, I co-produced it with a guy named Ray Kennedy, and he is a sonic genius, so I'm probably spoiled. He engineered and co-produced with Steve Earle the Lucinda Williams Car Wheels on a Gravel Road.
Mm-hmm.
We did the whole album to analog tape. We used old gear. Stephanie has a style that kind of throws back to the band and early Emmylou Harris and stuff like that. So I think I learned from him that when your sonics line up with the songwriting style, that it can sound really magical. And so I think that would be my only critique. And you know what? If this guy's in Albany, New York, you never know what he has access to. In Nashville, we have access to unbelievable amount of gear and engineering talent and mixing and all that. So it's nothing against the project. That would be my critique if we're demo derbying.
Oh, and we're just getting started right here.
Oh, boy.
Next up, from Arcadia, California, Crow Brothers and the song Are You Teasing Me?
Telling me
Brothers on Music Business Radio Demo Derby. They're from Arcadia, California. Crowbrothers.com if you like it. Nathan, did you like it?
I love it, and that should not be in the Demo Derby. That's not a demo. That sounds like a great recording where sonically the engineering and the mixing and the vocal sound and all that completely matches the style of the song. I'm reading the credits. I'm not going to be pretentious and say I knew this already, but it's a Leuven Brothers song. And
you know, he was a guest. Charlie Leuven has been on here before.
That's an unreal career right
Old
there.
Old school, yep.
Published by my publisher, Sony, AKF Rose. I love that. And I love that bluegrass harmony, the no vibrato sound. That's great. These guys are cool. I would go see that show.
You know, it's funny. When we started the show, and it was about 2005, I think, we originally called it the Demo Derby, but as we've picked up momentum ourselves, a lot of major labels and everybody sending us demos to get critiqued. Yeah. It's a little bit embarrassing when we play one and then the guest pans it. So, good call. All right, next up, Angela Siracusa, Hardly Heartbroke is the song, and she is also from Nashville.
Done like a burnt piece of bacon. Chance now, baby, you're a goner. I'm hardly heartbroken, just a little case of love gone bad. Hardly heartbroken, just a little scratch. It wasn't built to last. Love's a no-go, but I'm hardly heartbroken.
Angela Siracusa on Music Business Radio. If you like her, it's angelasiracusa.com. How about it, Nathan?
I think it's got a cool, like, Pam Tillis kind of throwback sound to it. I see my buddy on here, Billy Block. He's the co-producer. Love that guy. The sound that she's got going, that Pam Tillis kind of thing, is something that used to be right in the middle of the country radio format. But this sounds like something that is going to be in the kind of the lost country world, which a lot of times Americana will pick those artists up and celebrates them. This is probably not on top 40 radio right now, but it's really good.
You know, she had a really interesting line there, talked about burnt piece of bacon. It's always interesting to me to hear like the analogies and inspirations for songs. Where do you get your inspiration for a song?
Well, I'm kind of a weird mix. Got the creative side of my brain, and I've got the producer side of my brain, which a lot of being a producer is actually being anti-creative, trying to carve things, get rid of things.
Yeah.
When I sit down to write a song, there's like an element of self-expression and creativity just for the sake of being creative. But I have this overriding feeling in my head that I have to make sure that this is crafted well and could be on the radio and could be a hit, could be a single. Every once in a while, I'll write just an artsy song that I'm not worried about commercial stuff. And I'm not a commercial capitalist pig or anything. I'm doing my job. So when I'm songwriting, it's the same way when I'm playing guitar. It's like the Nathan the songwriter is trying to do a good job for Nathan the producer and do a good job for the artist.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually write better when I'm servicing a project as opposed to just writing a song in nebulous and then going through them and seeing, okay, do any of these work for commercial purposes? Mm-hmm. I'm kind of thinking about that the whole time I'm writing. Probably not the way most great songwriters write, but at the same time, it kind of works for me. It's where I feel like I'm doing my job. Outside of production, I've had a couple of moments where, as a songwriter, I got to get a cut that I had nothing to do with production-wise or playing or anything. Just on this new Martina McBride album that's coming out, I have a cut on there.
What's that like? Was that a surprise to you? I mean, that's just kind of...
That was unbelievable.
A big thrill, I would imagine.
Unbelievable, you know? What an honor. She cut two of the songs, actually, that I was writer on, and one of them is going on the album. You know, for an artist like that to think something of a song that you wrote, and you're not in the middle of the process, it's just a song that came in.
Mm-hmm.
It's a humongous honor. Chrissy Lee Cook from last year's American Idol, she cut one of my songs. And then I've had this guy, Tyler Hilton. Yeah. He's on Warner Brothers out in L.A. He cut a couple of things that he and I wrote together with John Alasia producing. I had a group called the McClimonts. They're an Australian group on Universal. I think it was the number one in Australia with them as a writer. A friend of mine, Adam Anders, produced that and co-wrote it. And so, yeah, it's like the songwriting thing is a completely different animal for me. It's actually an escape from the political dealings. It's an escape from paperwork and it's an escape from budgets. Mm-hmm. It's the only thing left that's just pure creativity, while at the same time I'm making sure that while I'm being creative that it's going to be able to mean something to somebody and maybe even be a hit one day, which would be dreamy.
What's your advice for upcoming songwriters?
If you can't help it but write artsy, you have no hit-making bone in your body. Own that, because there's a lot of people like that who've made tons of money and been very successful being that kind of writer. Don't kid yourself, but make your own albums and try to promote your music in a way that's not typical. If you're a hit songwriter, then own it and write smart. Write for projects. Try to write with artists. Do everything you can to get on projects. Don't measure yourself based on someone else's success. So, like, as an example, one of my favorite artists in the world, Lucinda Williams.
Mm-hmm.
If she were to look at her songwriting career and judge it against Jeffrey Steele, who's a big-time Nashville hit songwriter, you know, she may say, well, I haven't had a Rascal Flatts cut, so I'm not good. That would be unbelievably ridiculous.
Right.
And
it's still worth something.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness. It's like, I mean, the world celebrates her. I do, too. And she's had cuts. And she's had, you know, Tom Petty's cut her songs.
Yeah.
She had a huge hit with Mary Chapin Carpenter. What she does for the music industry is unbelievable. Me and my wife go to her shows and we worship her band. We worship her. We buy everything she puts out. She's a hero of ours. If you're a young artist, if you're a young Lucinda Williams, don't try to, just because you're in Nashville, try to be Jeffrey Steele or Craig mm-hmm. Wiseman or one of those people. Try to just own what you do and do it the best you can. And if you're a young Jeffrey Steele, don't think that you have to go and be Time Life songwriter, poet of the year in order to be successful. You know, like Bob Dylan or Lucinda Williams or Patti Griffin, you can just be a great commercial songwriter and do mm-hmm. something, you know?
Well, you know, we've actually had Jeffrey Steele on, and I asked him, so what's the secret to your success? And his thing was just being Jeffrey Steele. When I was finally Jeffrey Steele and trying to stop being other people,
yeah. It
worked for me. So I think that advice would work for everybody.
Absolutely.
You know, Jeffrey Steele is Jeffrey Steele, and that's the reason he's successful. So just like Lucinda, she is Lucinda.
And, you know, if I could do a shout out to Doug Pettibone, her guitar player. I've never met the guy. He doesn't know who I am, but he is one of my heroes. Like, I would take him to dinner. I would take him on a cruise just to hang out with a guy, ask him about his tones, how he's him, you know, where does he get his shirts? I love his shirts. I want to be that guy, you know? He's like a hero.
We're going to see if we can arrange that.
If you guys could do that, I would come back anytime.
Well, moving right along, Hannah Ford is next. Got a song called Fire in My Bones. Ford, Fire in My Bones. And if you like it, HannahFord.com. How about that, Nathan Chapman?
I think it's really cool. As a capitalist pig commercial songwriter, it's a little weird for the same lyric to happen three times in a row or two mm-hmm. times in a row. But that's what a lot of worship songs do.
I was wondering if it had that kind of Christian vibe to it.
Yeah, she's got a couple of scriptures underneath the title in the liner notes, Jeremiah 29 and Luke 19:40. So I get that. That's like a worship song style, to have repetition so everybody can learn the song and sing along. And it says produced and mixed by M.D. Thompson.
Yeah, she's from Louisiana.
I think it's really good. I think that M.D. Thompson guy, maybe he's a doctor of production, M.D. But I think he's great. And I see in the liner notes, my buddy Eric Darkin did some percussion on there. He plays on all the Taylor stuff.
I wonder if it was done here in Nashville, because she's not from here, but...
It looks like it was done in Houston, Texas, and California. But Eric Darkin can take you MP3 him a song, and he'll build tracks, and then he can mail you a DVD or upload it to an iDisc. Some of my productions, he'll just do stuff at his house.
We're about out of time. That's actually a great final question. How has technology changed all this? Because now a lot of people are recording in their homes, but you still got to have that production talent.
The studio industry is going through an adjustment period along with the music business. Everybody's trying to figure out how to do this with digital downloads being so prevalent. You can go to Guitar Center, and in an hour you could walk out with a full studio to make an album on it. I have this theory in my head that pop music is what regular people do every day creatively on their own, that someone does better than everybody. Pop being popular music. I think with the garage band being out there, people are being really creative with loops, and they're making their own songs and stuff. And I feel like that in a modern production, you have to kind of incorporate what people are doing in their houses into your stuff so it feels familiar to them.
Mm-hmm.
I use Logic. I use GarageBand in my productions, even on this new Sara Evans on Taylor's Fearless. There's Logic loops. There's loops that people have in their GarageBand programs.
Wow.
In the 60s and 70s, everybody had an acoustic guitar and could sing a song and grow their hair long. You know, who's going to keep you from growing your hair long and saying, I'm a songwriter, dude? And that, you know, at the time, so then it would be like the heroes of that time were the people who did that better than everybody else.
Right, right. So it's but got something familiar, though.
Yeah. So, like, if you went back in time and had the GarageBand Logic Pro Tools mentality kind of song, it'd probably be a colossal failure because they're not doing that at home. You know, people at home are, at the time, were on acoustic guitars. Now they're on GarageBand, and feel like that's why music sounds the way it does right now and feels the way it does, is because that creative spark coming from someone just sitting at their computer and making a song. People want to feel that when they hear the big dogs do it.
Well, you know, I mentioned earlier about Taylor. She has kind of that vulnerability in her voice and that comes through in her production. And I think maybe that's why she's so big. It's like people see themselves within her. And that's kind of what you're talking about with the sounds they're coming out with.
Yeah, I think it's accessible because it's real. And it's something that it's a little bigger than... A lot of people feel the way she feels. A lot of people like the same music she likes, and it's accessible. It's something that people can relate to. But at the same time, you're rolling along, you're making commercial music, you're thinking about, let's incorporate GarageBand into this and that, and doing all those smart things, and then, boom, Norah Jones is a jazz artist, and she's gigantic, you know? Or where you're rolling along with the hair band and then Nirvana. It's like, the great thing about commercial music is that all those rules and all the smarts that we try to have are completely obliterated when someone comes along. And I think that for my career with Taylor, these two albums that we've made and the remixes and everything have a little bit of that element to them. And Nashville was chugging along, doing its thing, and then boom, this young girl with these issues that in her head, the subject matter she wanted to sing about, the style of her songwriting just kind of sideswiped everybody. And I love that. I love being a part of one of those moments in music.
Where can people get more information on you?
Well, I have a website, nathanchapman.com. I just have my credits listed and the companies that I endorse, and they endorse me, like Apogee and Logic, Aventone microphones. Ray Kennedy turned me onto those. Paul Reed Smith guitars. I've just got like some links, got my credits, my nominations and stuff listed.
How about ways for people to send their music to you? Are you taking demos at all?
If they want to send their music to me, I have at Sony ATV, this would probably just be for local people here, but at Sony ATV, there's a Dropbox where people can drop CDs off for me.
So is that on 17th Avenue?
It is on 17th
Avenue.
All
right, so 17th Avenue in Nashville, Tennessee, if you're smart enough to find where it is, there's a Dropbox with Nathan Chapman's name on it.
And maybe this would be a nice way to close or whatever, and definitely not me trying to compliment myself in any way, but I will say that I went up and down Music Row when I first decided I wanted to be a producer with my demo reel of stuff that I'd done before I had gotten any of the work with Liz Rose or anything. And I actually went into Sony and dropped off a demo reel trying to get them to give that to writers to show them that I could do their songwriting demos. And about 6 months later, I went in and picked up my first check for doing a demo for one of the writers. And now I'm a writer there. And so if somebody brings a demo in to Sony for me to listen to, I don't take that lightly because I'm just about 5 minutes away from having been the person dropping off the demo. So I get bogged down. I can't listen to everything I want to. But just the fact that someone would walk into Sony with a demo, I did that about 5 or 6 years ago. And so there you go.
So I don't know, whatever that's worth. It can happen, and it can happen.
Well, I don't want to be the guy. I don't want to be the guy at the convention. It can happen to you, you know, like, I don't want to be the guy with the...
Hold on to your dreams.
Right, I don't want to be that guy. I'm not a motivational speaker, but I will say the reality is that we're all trying, and there's a lot of people out there who are tuned to the show who have dreams, and I still have dreams, you know?
Somebody's got to have the number one record, might as well be you, right?
I'll take it. I'll absolutely take it, but let's all keep dreaming together and keep working hard and making great music. That's what I would love.
Great final advice. For more on Nathan Chapman, check him out, NathanChapman.com. And for more from us on Music Business Radio, check us out, MusicBusinessRadio.com. Thanks for listening. Thanks to everybody who sent in demos. And we'll see you next week where I'll interview another industry guest.
Thank you for listening to Music Business Radio. Music Business Radio is a production of Lightning 100 Tuned In Broadcasting Incorporated, Nashville, Tennessee. Produced by Gary Crane, Dan Buckley, and David Hooper. Pro Tools post-production by Justin Hamill. Production coordination by Jesse Smith. And Lester cleaned the toilet. Pro audio support provided today by DigiDesign with exclusive in-studio guitars courtesy of Waterstone Musical Instruments. For more information about Music Business Radio, visit musicbusinessradio.com. We are Music Business Radio, broadcasting from WRLT Studios at Marathon Village, Nashville, Tennessee. Music.